Welcome back to the discussion on theoretical abstractions in data flow analysis. In the first part of the lecture, we looked at an example of constant propagation and we observed that the setting of bit vector frameworks is not general enough to accommodate frameworks such as constant propagation, and hence there is a need to generalize our observations. We will do so in the rest of this module. What we would like to do is we would like to talk about data flow values, we would like to talk about acceptable operations on data flow values, we would like to talk about desired solutions, and we would like to talk about practical algorithms to compute these desired solutions. And there are many other minor points, there are many other issues that we will address when we talk about data flow values. So today, let us start talking about the data flow values. We begin by taking an overview of what we need, and then we will talk about the specific details. So here is an outline of our discussion about data flow. We need a notion of abstraction. We'll talk about lattices, we'll talk about different variants of lattices, and then we'll talk about relevance of lattices for data flow analysis. Why do we use lattice theoretic modeling of data flow analysis? In a nutshell, we will see that partial order relation is something that serves as a very nice abstraction to represent approximation of data flow values. And we will see that meet operations are something that give us nice way of merging the data flow values. Then we'll talk about how to construct lattices, and we'll talk about examples of lattices. So here is a small digression on lattices. We begin by discussing partially ordered sets. In general, when we talk about sets, we do not distinguish between ordering of the elements. A set containing A, B is same as a set containing B, A. However, here we are not talking about a set changing because of the positions of the elements. We are not talking about ordering as in positioning elements at different places. Here we are talking about ordering in terms of comparing elements with each other. And we can have a sense of comparison and order the elements by comparison, by the result of comparison. So there are three kinds of orders that we talk about. One is a total order. A set is totally ordered if every element is compared with every element, including itself. For example, the set of integers is a totally ordered set where the comparison operator is less than equal to or greater than equal to. Then there is a discrete order where every element is compared only with itself and not with any other element. For example, we might say set of variables has a discrete order. We do not want to compare first variable with other variable with some other variable. The third order is a partial order. A set is partially ordered if an element is comparable with itself and some other elements, but not necessarily with all elements. So we are interested in this partial order, and this forms a very nice mathematical tool for describing what happens when we perform data flow analysis. So we have partially ordered sets. So this shows you, this oval shows you a set of all partially ordered sets. And a partial order has the following properties. A partial order is a relation which is reflexive, which is transitive, and antisymmetric. All these three properties have to be satisfied. A relation is reflexive if every element is related with itself. A relation is transitive if when A is related to B and B is related to C, we can say A is related to C under the same relation. And a relation is antisymmetric if when A is related to B and B is related to A, this is possible only when A and B are identical. We define a lower bound of two elements in a set X, Y. We say that a lower bound of elements X and Y is an element U, is an element U such that U is partially ordered with respect to X and U is also partially ordered with respect to Y. So because U is partially ordered with both, U is a lower bound of X. We read this relation as weaker than relation. We say U is weaker than X or U is weaker than Y. In some places, people also call this less than equal to. So U is less than equal to X and U is less than equal to Y. Here, this less than equal to need not necessarily be a quantitative comparison. It's just a relation that orders these elements. And this less than equal to should just be seen as something that orders U with respect to X and U with respect to Y. Like a lower bound, we also define an upper bound of two elements X and Y, which is U, such that in this case now X is weaker than U and Y is weaker than U. So when U is weaker than both X and Y, U is a lower bound of X and Y. When X and Y are both weaker than U, U is an upper bound of X and Y. So like this, we can define lower bounds and upper bounds of not just pairs of elements, but sets of elements. So lattices are special kind of partially ordered sets which have the following property. And the property is that every non-empty finite subset of this partially ordered set has a greatest lower bound denoted GLB and a least upper bound denoted LUB. Then such a partially ordered set is called a lattice. So this is the definition of the lattice. This is the requirement that must be satisfied by a partially ordered set for it to be called a lattice. When this requirement is not satisfied, we just have a partially ordered set which is not a lattice, and we will see examples of this. Note that GLB, which is greatest lower bound, must be related to all other lower bounds. It's supposed to be greatest of all lower bounds. So therefore, all lower bounds must be weaker than the greatest lower bound, and hence it must be unique. In a similar manner, the least upper bound is the least among all upper bounds, and therefore it must be related to all upper bounds, and hence it must also be unique. We can't have two GLBs of a set and rather multiple GLBs of a set or a multiple LUBs of a set. In that case, the overall partially ordered set is not a lattice. So here is an example of a partially ordered set. We talk about this set containing these integers as finite set. We are not including all integers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 9, 12 with partial order relation as divides. We say A is weaker than B if and only if A divides B. And when we say A divides B, it means that there is no remainder. A divides it completely with remainder being 0. So it's easy to see that 6 does not divide 9, but 3 divides 9. So using this concept, we show a partial order like this. This is called a Hasse diagram. So we say that 4 divides 12 and therefore 4 is weaker than 12. and we draw four below 12 with a line showing their relationship. Similarly, 6 divides 12. So we have 6 weaker than 12 and this line. And now we have 2 divides 4, therefore we have 2 below 4 and a line like this. And then we have 2 divides 6, therefore we have an edge from 6 to 2. And then 1 divides 2, so therefore we have an edge from between 1 and 2. Similarly, 3 divides 6, and therefore we have an edge between 6 and 3. And 3 also divides 9, and therefore we know we have an edge between 9 and 3. Note that 12 divides itself. Divides is a reflexive relation. Note that if 4 divides 12 and 2 divides 4, then 2 divides 12. So divides is also a transitive relation. Note that if a number divides some other number, if A divides B and B also divides A, this is possible if and only if A is equal to B, and therefore divides relation is also antisymmetric, and therefore divides is a valid partial order. In general, any relation that satisfies these three requirements, it's reflexive, it's antisymmetric, and it's transitive, any relation that has these three properties is a valid partial order. Now, is this partially ordered set a lattice? So the answer is no, because subset 4, 9, 6, so 4, 6 and 9 does not have an upper bound in the set. We do not have any element such that 4, 6 and 9, all three of them divide that element. We do not have any element within the lattice such that 4, 6 and 9 divide that element. Similarly, the subset 12 and 9, we do not have an upper bound of 12 and 9. We do not have any number within the set which is divided by both 12 and 9. So this is an example of a partially ordered set which is not a lattice. So what will be a lattice? We can convert this into a lattice by adding these two elements, 36 and 18. And now it's easy to see that here every non-empty finite subset of this particular set has an upper bound. And by an upper bound, we mean a number which is divided by all elements in this subset. Similarly, every subset of 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 9, 12, 18, 36 has a lower bound, which means that there exists a number within the set which divides all these numbers. If we talk about 12 and 6, 18, their lower bound is 6. If we talk about 12 and 9, their lower bound is 1. If we talk about 2 and 3, their upper bound is 6. If we talk about 2 and 9, their lower bound is 1 and upper bound is 18. If we talk about 4 and 9, their lower bound is 1 and the lower bound of 4 and 9 is 36. And therefore, this is a lattice. Having defined a lattice, now we define something called a complete lattice. So what is a lattice? A lattice is a partially ordered set such that every non-empty finite subset has a GLB and a lub. Okay. Consider the lattice Z of integers, the set Z of integers under less than equal to relation. If we pick up any finite subset, we have a greatest lower bound. We know that we know the number which is smaller than all these things, and we know the number which is larger than all these things. So we have a GLB and lub all finite subsets. However, if we pick up an infinite subset, we do not have a GLB or lub. When we are given an infinite set of integers, we can't say which is the largest integer among them and which is the smallest integer among them. So this set Z of integers is a lattice, but is not a complete lattice. A complete lattice is a partially ordered set, or a complete lattice is a lattice in which even empty subset and infinite subsets have a GLB and a lub. This is interesting. Now we are saying that infinite subsets also must have a GLB. So the main difference between the definition of a lattice and a complete lattice is that a complete lattice is a lattice where we drop these requirements, non-empty finite subset. We simply say a complete lattice is a partially ordered set such that every subset has a GLB and finite. We remove the restriction that these subsets must be non-empty or these subsets must be finite. We now allow for empty subset as well as infinite subset. So now we take the same set Z of integers under less than relationship and we augment it with positive infinity and minus infinity, and now this becomes a complete lattice. If we are given an infinite set of integers, we can certainly find out the largest number among them and the smallest number among them. If we have we might have all positive numbers, let's say, then the smallest number is 0 and then the largest number is positive infinity. If you have all negative numbers, then we know that the largest number is 0 and the smallest number is the negative infinity. We define two important elements in a lattice, something called a top and a bottom. And a top element is something that occupies the top position in the lattice, and a bottom element is something that occupies the bottom position in the lattice, which means that the top element is something such that every element is weaker than the top element. This is shown by this symbol that resembles T, and the bottom element is shown by this symbol that is inverse of T, that's T turned upside down. The property of top element is that every element is weaker than top element, and the property of bottom element is that bottom element is weaker than every element. And these two form very useful elements in our scheme of things. So we talk about Z union infinity minus infinity is a complete lattice. So it's easy for us to see that infinite subsets of Z union infinity minus infinity have a GLB and a lub. But what about empty set? We have to also be able to reason about empty set. Now, this is an interesting reasoning that we should be aware of. We say that the greatest lower bound of empty set is top. Note that we are talking about lower bound, not upper bound. Where every element is lower than top. So how can top be the greatest lower bound of empty set? So the mathematical argument is something like this. A formal argument is something like this. Every element of Z union this is vacuously a lower bound of an element in empty set. We say that every element contained in this is a lower bound of an element in this set. This is vacuously true because there is no element in empty set. And therefore, it goes without saying that every element is a lower bound of element within empty set. which one is the largest such element. So we have all these lower bounds and we have to find out the greatest lower bound. So which one is the greatest element among them? The greatest element is the top element. And therefore, GLB of empty set is top. Okay. There is another way of arguing about this. If instead of weaker than relation, if we talk about its dual stronger than relation, then we say that every element in empty set is stronger than every element in this set. This is vacuously true because there is no element in empty set, and therefore it satisfies this requirement. And therefore every element is stronger, and then we want to find out the largest element in Z, and that becomes the greatest lower bound of the empty set. Okay, so greatest among all these lower bounds is top, and therefore GLB of empty set is top. In a similar manner, we say that lub of empty set is bottom. This is very nice because it allows us, it gives us a guarantee that no matter which subset we talk about, we have GLB and lub defined. And as we shall see later, that this is a very, very useful property. It just says that we will be able to perform approximations of data flow values without any exception. So there are two important operations on lattices. We once again go back to the same lattice of integers under divides by relation. There are these two operations called meet and join. This is a square cup and this is called this is a square cap and this is a square cup. So this is called a meet operation and this is called a join operation. So we define meet operation. X meet Y computes the GLB of X and Y, which means that X meet Y computes a Z such that Z is weaker than X and Z is weaker than Y. But there is something more than that. Among all possible such Z prime elements which are weaker than both X and Y, Z is the greatest among them. So it's the greatest lower bound of X and Y. Similarly, we define the join element to compute the lub of X and Y, which means that X join Y computes a Z such that Z is an upper bound of X and Z is an upper bound of Y. But this is not all. It so happens that if there is some Z prime which is an upper bound of X and also an upper bound of Y, then we know that Z is a lower bound of this upper bound, meaning Z is the least of all upper bounds of X and Y. Here, the way we show these edges, this the lower bound of the join of 12 and 18 is 36 and the meet of 12 and 18 is 6. So it has to be an element that is as close to these two elements as possible. Similarly, the join of 4 and 9 is 36. And the meet of 4 and 9 is 1. An interesting property of join and meet operations is that both these operations are commutative, associative, and idempotent. And we shall see later why this commutativity, associativity, and idempotence is useful in data flow analysis. We will also see why the properties of partial order being reflexive, antisymmetric, and transitive is useful and relevant in data flow analysis. Now we also have top and bottom elements. So we know that this top element is such that the meet of any element with top is X, because X meet top is going to compute the greatest lower bound. and the greatest such element between x and top will be x. Similarly, x joint top is top, x meet bottom is bottom, and x join bottom is x. Now for our lattice, what are these join and meet operations? So it turns out that the join here is something that computes the LCM, the lowest common multiple of given two numbers, and the meet computes the greatest common divisor of given two numbers. It's easy to see that the lowest common multiple of 4 and 9 is the lowest common multiple of 4 and 9 is 36, and the greatest common divisor of 4 and 9 is 1. And similarly, we can compute all join and meet of every pair of elements.